Very well. Welcome, everyone. Welcome back to the Foundations of Quantum Mechanics. Right now, we are discussing decoherence, so the loss of quantum interference. And I told you last time that what we want to look at now as a next step is decoherence of macroscopic objects. So that brings us to the favorite topic of everyone first getting interested in the foundations of quantum mechanics, which is Schrödinger's cat. Now, first I describe Schrödinger's cat and then I can tell you what it has to tell us about decoherence. Schrödinger invented this example actually to not to say that this is possible, but rather to say in the early days of quantum mechanics that quantum mechanics gives rise to very weird predictions. And so what was then known in 1935 about quantum mechanics could not yet be the last word. So that was the spirit of his Gedanken experiment. So here's the Gedanken experiment. He says there's a, say, box in which there is an atom that can decay. For example, the nucleus can decay. If it decays, then it will trigger, will be able to trigger a counter. Think of a Geiger counter. And this will trigger a device whereby a vial of poison is broken and the poison is released and will poison the cat. And so the cat will die. And so if you have left the system unattended for some while, then either the atom has decayed or it has not decayed. If it has not decayed, the situation is as in the beginning. If it has decayed, the poison has been released and the cat is dead. And so what's so weird about this is that something that is at first microscopic, namely what goes on in the atom, which level it is in, which can easily be in a superposition, so no one would complain that microscopic things are in a superposition, that this microscopic superposition is then by this process somewhat transferred to a macroscopic superposition. And that is so strange. So Schrödinger took that as an indication that we don't yet know everything about quantum mechanics, and he assumed that these strange things would go away in a more detailed analysis. Nowadays, we are not so sure. Nowadays, we rather think this has to be taken serious. And there are many indications for this. At the same time, he also coined the term entanglement in this case, because if we write down the full state, we could say the atom is actually decayed with some likelihood. And if you like, I can write this as spin down or decayed. Which is going along with the cat being dead and all the other processes having happened. So the vial of the poison is broken and so on. Plus, in a superposition, the atom is still not decayed, and the cat is alive. So this is clearly an entangled state. And this 1935 paper where Schrödinger introduced the cat was also the same way introduced the notion of entanglement. And the whole paper is basically a response to the Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen paper that just came out a little bit earlier. Now, we won't follow Schrödinger's argument that this shows that something is weird with quantum mechanics. We want to take it serious. And there are now many different angles you can have on this. One is the measurement perspective. So the whole setting could be interpreted as a rather strange way of measuring the state of the atom, which will lead in one of the states to the cat being dead. So the cat and all the other stuff are like the measurement apparatus, and dead or alive, these are the two pointer states of the measurement. But this is not the perspective we now want to take. Rather, we want to consider the important fact that the cat is really a macroscopic, even a living object. And so it's a little bit strange that it can be in a superposition state. Now, strictly speaking, the cat alone is not in a superposition. It's entangled with the atom. But we can easily get rid of this if we don't like this by rewriting the state where we would say, aha, I can also say my atom is in a superposition of up and down, And the cat is alive plus dead plus the same kind of term with a minus in between everything. You can convince yourself up to a normalization factor that this is the same state. And now what people would do if they had produced this entangled state and really wanted to produce a superposition state of the macroscopic object on its own would be that they measure the atom in this basis where you distinguish up plus down from up minus down. And at the end of this measurement in this basis, you will get either one of the two possibilities. Say, for example, you get up plus down as a state of the atom, and then automatically, according to the rules of quantum mechanics, this will collapse the state of the cat into the superposition of alive and dead. And then it's really a superposition. It's no longer entangled with anything. So this is what we want to discuss. We want to discuss macroscopic superposition states of the sort alive plus dead, or a big object being in one or the other position. Now, obviously no one has ever done this with a cat, but there have been many attempts to try to produce macroscopic superposition states. And the reason is that no one knows whether possibly quantum mechanics might break down in this regime. So it's worthwhile to investigate. So the question is, what have been some of these attempts to produce macroscopic superpositions? Here's a little outline of the various approaches people have tried. The most advanced approach at the moment is probably interference experiments using very large objects, specifically large molecules. So this is what I'm showing here. This is the most advanced approach to generating superpositions of macroscopic objects. And I will say a little bit more in a moment. There are other slightly more abstract things. For example, people relatively early considered superconducting devices. And there's a certain kind, a superconducting quantum interference device, or SQUID, where you have electric currents running and you can, by proper manipulation, put it in a superposition state of an electric current running at the same time clockwise and counterclockwise. And since the electric current is carried by many electrons, maybe 1,000 or so going in either direction, this can also reasonably count as a macroscopic superposition state. Then there are other more recent developments. For example, it was discovered about 15 years ago or so that you can use light and the radiation pressure force to very efficiently manipulate the mechanical motion of macroscopic objects. In particular, for example, the vibrations of a mirror at the end of an optical cavity. This is a field called cavity optomechanics. And since you have so much control, this can also be used to place the mirror into a superposition state. And then finally, there are very recent experiments ongoing where people try to take levitated spheres, say in the 100 nanometer size regime, and also place those into superposition states, which would then also be macroscopic in the sense they contain many, many atoms. But for now, the most reliable results and the most clear-cut results have been obtained for the large molecules. So I want to spend a moment to tell you about it. These are experiments being done in the group of Markus Arndt in Vienna. They are basically meta-wave interference experiments. So you have some source of molecules. You send them through a series of gratings to produce an interference pattern. One of these gratings is actually a grating made not of out of a material, but out of a standing wave of light, a so-called optical lattice that then can also deflect the molecules and has certain advantages. And then finally, you want to observe the interference pattern, and that you do by ionizing the molecules and then registering them. The most important question is, how large are these molecules? How large are our cats? And it's really up to 2,000 atoms so far. So that's a record only achieved a few years ago. These are very, very sensitive and complicated experiments. For example, the whole setup is suspended, so you can guard against vibrations, which would introduce noise. They also have even to compensate the Coriolis force due to the rotation of the Earth, because this alone would also smear the interference pattern a little bit. And they have to take other precautions as to watch, for example, the thermal radiation of the molecules. You don't want to have any gas around and so on. So these are very challenging experiments, but they are also very sensitive and they are, so to speak, the record holders in this domain. Now, what we want to discuss now is coming back to our topic of decoherence. When I do have such big objects, why is it that we so rarely observe superposition or interference of these macroscopic objects? And the reason is, of course, the fundamental reason is decoherence. And so we want to ask, how does decoherence, how does loss of interference by noise, how does this loss of interference scale with a particle number? That's the first question you ask when you talk about the size of a cat. And so again, I don't want to discuss a real cat at the moment. I also don't want to discuss even these more complicated mechanical objects. Let's just treat a little toy model. So a superposition state where a rather large object composed of many different particles is placed into a superposition. And I want to consider the simplest case that would be particles that can have spin up or spin down, and I will consider n of them. So if I want to write down what would count as a macroscopic superposition state, I will say that instead of having a single spin up or down in a superposition state, I will produce a superposition of this GHZ Greenberger-Horn-Zeilinger type. So you remember that would be all spins up, that's the blue state, plus all spins down, that's the red state. Now, how would you even test the interference? That's already where it gets interesting, and it comes back to something we discussed for measurement physics. You cannot test the fact that there is this superposition by looking only at a single particle observable. For example, if you try to measure the properties of spin one, then it will act as if it is in a completely incoherent mixture, 50% classical spin up, 50% spin down. You don't see any coherence between these states. What you have to do in such a complicated state, which observable you have to consider, is actually a many particle observable. So this kind of observable that would be in this case a product of all the sigma x of all the spin x operators for all the spins simultaneous. It is actually a little bit hard to produce such an observable, but it can be done. People who are doing experiments on quantum computers would certainly be able to construct for you such an observable and try to measure it. And if coherence is perfect, if we have the state displayed here, then you can calculate the expectation value of this money particle operator. And if you go through the little calculation, it would turn out to be perfect and exactly one. Here's the first question. Why do you use a GHZ state for the comparison? In the diffraction experiments, there's only 1 degree of freedom in which the parts of the wave function differ the position. Okay, that's a very good and highly interesting point. So it actually teaches us that these things are a little bit basis dependent. So let's consider a case where indeed I have a few particles either up here in an interference experiment, or I have the same molecule with the same number of particles down here. So how to describe this superposition state? I could indeed say that I work with new coordinates, namely one is the center of mass coordinate, all the others are separate, and then it would seem like only having a superposition in the center of mass coordinate and not in any of the other coordinates. On the other hand, I can as well say that I have a superposition of I have a superposition where if I call this position up, and for brevity, I call it spin up, and this position I call down, then I could say, and I number the particles, then I could say, aha, I have all the particles, each of them individually, being up, plus I have all the particles, each of them individually, being down. So that would be precisely this GHZ state. So now the question is, which of these approaches is better? Because you're right, I can write it down in the center of mass coordinates, and then I would say in this new basis, something like up for center of mass, plus down, so the other position for the center of mass, times the wave function of the relative coordinates of the molecule. So the question, which one is better? And I think on this formal level, it is undecided. But it turns out that if you then do ask about why are these superpositions so fragile, why are they so easily destroyed, then it turns out the coupling of the environment, for example, noisy fluctuating fields that come in from the background, it turns out this coupling is to each individual particle. And so this is, so to speak, the proper basis to discuss the decoherence, versus that would not be the proper basis to discuss the decoherence. But yes, you raised a very important point. On the very abstract formal level, it is not so obvious. But I may remind you that also on the very abstract formal level, even whether a state is entangled or not is not so obvious. In order to discuss entanglement, you have to split your system into two pieces. And if someone only talks about an abstract Hilbert space, you wouldn't know how to do this. You have to talk about the physical situation to say, oh, I want to split it into the two pieces that belong to different areas in space, for example. So these are these questions that can only be answered if you come back to the physics, so to speak. Anyway, so this is the reason, because the decoherence will be best described in this basis. Okay. So now we want to introduce decoherence. Again, I want to make it simple for us. If we take for a moment serious these spins, one well-known source of decoherence for a spin is, for an electron spin, for example, is that it may have a lot of other spins around it. Think of nuclear spins, which are randomly oriented. And so this is the situation I want to consider. Each of these little collections of nuclear spins exerts a kind of effective field on my spin that I'm interested in, the spin of the system, and therefore gives rise to a kind of noise, or there is interaction between the system that I'm interested in and this so-called spin bath, which means an uncontrollable environment. And so if this is the situation, then, and they have interacted for some time, then what will happen, as usual, as we know it already from the measurement process, is that this little environment made of these smaller spins will evolve into a state that depends on the state of my actual spins of interest. And if I number them, then I could say there's the state chi up one for this first spin, and there's a corresponding state of the spin bath for the second spin and for the third, and so on. So you see, it's very similar to all our discussions of measurement. And likewise, in case the spins have been down, then there are corresponding states of the surrounding spin bath under the assumption that the central spin has been down. Okay, so this is the situation after some time. Again, I want to look at the same observable, because we know this is sensitive to the relative phase between the two superposition states. And if I now calculate the expectation value of this observable, then I will find the following. Again, it's a short calculation. I will just find the product of the overlaps of these bath states. In a measurement setting, I would call them pointer states. Now, I want to emphasize that all these extra degrees of freedom are rather uncontrollable, like a heat bath. So I call them the bath states. And, well, this is a quantity that we had looked at earlier when we discussed decoherence and its relation to the measurement process. So let's call that the coherence, the overlap factor between the different bath states. And in the simplest case, where all these spins are identical and all these baths have identical properties, yet they are separate. In this simplest case, of course, each of the factors is the same and we just get the nth power. And so here you can see for the first time very, very clearly how this scales with the size of our cat, so to speak. It scales pretty badly, it scales exponentially. So if C is even 0.9, so that for an individual spin, it wouldn't be that bad. If you raise it to a large power, then of course you get a very small number and the interference vanishes very rapidly. So that is the fate of cats. Decoherence is very rapid with the size of the cat. It turns out that this dependence on the size of the cat is not even universal. It depends on the properties of the environment and the interaction with this environment. So we just discussed a case where each of the spins that are part of my cat, they have each of them their own separate bath. And then we had the exponential dependence on the number of spins making up the cat. We can have cases that are even worse. For example, if all the spins of my cat, they feel the same noisy fluctuating magnetic field, which you can think of as coming from another spin bath, which now, however, couples globally to all of them simultaneously, then things get worse. Then we can even have situations where this expectation value, that is the suppression of the interference term, goes exponentially with the square of the number of particles. So in general, this will depend very much on the details and in the proper mathematical analysis of these effects, you would start asking questions like, let me describe the effects of my environment, of my bath, as a kind of fluctuating field, fluctuating in space and time. And let me ask about what are the correlation functions of this field. So how strongly are the noisy fluctuating values at different points in space and time correlated? And how that correlation decays with a distance, for example. And then you can even have situations where this would scale with another power of n in the exponent. And likewise, here we were just discussing the size, just as an aside. We can also discuss how the overlap factor decreases with time. That's a natural question to ask. And when we look at how it decreases with time, we again encounter many different possibilities for how it can behave. There could be an exponential decay in time. There could be something like a Gaussian decay in time. There can be a power law decay in time. And so there are many scenarios, and again, it will depend on the details of the interaction with the environment and the properties of the environment. So if you would listen to a course on decoherence, which can run a whole semester, then this is the kind of things you would learn. And actually, decoherence is one of my specialties, but unfortunately, now in this course, we want to concentrate it only on the basics. Okay. So this is how these cats decohere. Are there any questions at the moment? Okay, I don't hear any. Then I want to discuss another very interesting aspect since we're discussing these Schrödinger cats and we are making the claim they are macroscopic. You want to say, what is the size of a Schrödinger cat? For example, if you're an experimentalist and you're putting a lot of effort into creating such macroscopic superposition states, you want to say that my Schrödinger cat is really much larger than all the other Schrödinger cats that have been produced so far. So how do you do this? Now, at first sight, it seems simple. If you have a molecule with 100 atoms or a molecule with 200 atoms, the one with 200 atoms is larger than the one with 100 atoms. But I told you that there are many different possible experimental settings. It's not so easy to compare each of them. And also there are actually many settings where the situation is less clear than in a simple molecular interferometer. And I've shown here one example. If you have a sphere and you bring it into a superposition of these two states, so one, the blue one, where it's slightly to the left, and the red one, where it's slightly to the right, and say the sphere has a billion atoms, would you then say that you have created a Schrödinger cat with a billion atoms? At first sight, maybe yes. But on the other hand, maybe this is a little bit unfair, because in this overlap region, actually nothing much has happened. In principle, only maybe you should only count the amount of atoms that are in the region where there is really no overlap between the two superimposed states. And that would immediately make the size of this cat, in this definition, make the size of the cat dependent on how far apart are the two objects in the two pieces of the superposition. So this is the kind of question that comes up when you ask about the size of Schrödinger cat. So it's not completely unambiguous. And it turns out that there is no unique single answer trying to say what is the size of a Schrödinger cat. Rather, over time, people have come up with a variety of different answers, each of which focuses on a different aspect. And I just want to very briefly mention this. So one of the first ideas is this one here, due to Tony Leggett, who won the Nobel Prize for his explanation of helium-3. If you look at, for example, such a squid, current running clockwise or counterclockwise, then associated to this current is also a magnetic moment that is pointing up or down. And you could estimate the difference in magnetic moment for the two situations that are in a superposition state. You would find something like, oh, it's 10 to the 10 times mu Bohr, the Bohr magneton, which is the microscopic unit of magnetic moment. And in that sense, then you could say, aha, there's a macroscopic superposition, a large difference with respect to some microscopic reference unit. Okay, so that's not unreasonable, a little bit qualitative maybe, but not unreasonable. Leggett also came up with another measure that is actually far more mathematical. So I will just very briefly mention, if the overall object is made out of n particles, let's say, you can consider what happens if I split these capital N particles into two pieces, one on the left and one on the right. This is this situation that people also like to consider when they talk about entanglement. And you would consider the entropy of the subsystem as it evolves as a function of the size of the subsystem. And based on that, he has a definition that he calls the disconnectivity, which in some cases gives reasonable answers of the sort that you would expect. Okay. There's another maybe related approach. Again, imagine you have capital N subunits, like capital N spins or particles or whatever. And you ask the question, how many particles would I need to measure to be able to distinguish the branches? That's a good idea. If you need to measure only a single particle, then maybe only the single particle was in a superposition state and the rest was not even participating. So it's boring. It's not a cat. When the state would be in a product state. Okay, I guess this is a little bit more complicated to explain. In any case, you ask yourself how many particles need to be measured to distinguish the branches, and from that you can derive the possible size of the Schrödinger cat. Here's another possibility that actually we invented. If you imagine your particles being arranged in a set of single particle levels, occupying different single particle levels, you can ask yourself, how many particles would I need to move between these single particle levels to go from one part of the macroscopic superposition, so this state, into the other part of the macroscopic superposition? And in the example shown here, these would just be two particles. So you would say, aha, effectively only two particles are distinct in the two branches of the macroscopic superposition. So all the other particles are only spectators, so I shouldn't count them. Then there is an older version that was a little bit more restricted, analyzing a particular class of states, namely so-called generalized GHZ states, where instead of having up, up, up plus down, 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 you say I only, in the other branch of the superposition, maybe my spin in each case is only tilted a little bit, so it still has a lot of overlap with the original spin state. And that means if this GHZ state has n particles, it should not count completely as a superposition of size n. It should count as something smaller. And this they analyzed by looking at the stability versus decoherence and by looking at entanglement. And then finally, the most recent measure on this list is one by Nimrichter and Hornberger, where the idea is, well, if the reason we are struggling to produce these large superpositions is really fragility due to decoherence, maybe we can use that also to measure in general the size of these cats. And very precisely, they say these cats should be a tool to check whether there is any extra sources, maybe fundamental sources of decoherence around. And if the superposition state, if the cat state is able to very sensitively rule out these extra sources of decoherence, then we take this as an indication that it's actually a really macroscopic superposition. So a big cat is very sensitive to decoherence, and that we take as an indication that it is a big cat in the first place. And that's a very nice definition, which in particular applies very well to these molecular interference experiments and teaches us how big they should be considered. Okay. So much about the size of a Schrödinger cat. Is there any question about this? If you like, you can also try to come up with your own measure. But again, people over time have come to the agreement that different measures emphasize different aspects. Okay, so then I move on. And I want to conclude this section on decoherence by introducing something that is a very important concept in this field, which is this so-called system bath picture of decoherence. I will not go into the details of how to calculate decoherence. Again, that would be a whole lecture series, but you should at least know about the system bath picture. And I take the opportunity then also to introduce some typical sources of decoherence that occur in actual practice. So what is this system bath picture? The idea is you have your quantum system of interest. It could be this molecule, or it could be a levitated sphere, or it could be a qubit or a whole quantum computer. And then there's the rest of the world. And interestingly, the system is not completely isolated from the rest of the world, but rather there are links, so to speak. There is interaction with the rest of the world. The rest of the world is called a bath, in the spirit of heat bath, which is some uncontrollable big environment made up of many degrees of freedom, with which you interact, possibly weakly, but nevertheless you interact with it. So that's the idea. And so then the question is, what could be this bath and what could be this interaction? And if we stay for a moment with these molecules, then a typical bath could be just gas, some surrounding gas. And these gas molecules from time to time can hit my molecule. And if they hit my molecule, they will give rise to vibrations, and also they will give a kick to the whole molecule, a center of mass, and this can have the tendency to smear out my interference pattern and lead to decoherence. So that's collisions with gas molecules. And the conclusion from that is, of course, if you want to produce these superposition states, you better work in a good vacuum. Next thing, thermal radiation. These molecules, interestingly, are rather hot. And since they are rather hot, they can emit infrared radiation. But if they do so, they will give they will receive a kind of a back reaction. So there will be a momentum kick in the opposite direction if you emit a photon into one direction. And this also, since it's noisy, has a tendency to smear the interference pattern. Also, the molecules could not just emit thermal radiation, but if there is some thermal radiation around in the vicinity, then this, of course, can come in from the outside, scatter off the molecule, and again, lead to decoherence. And just very briefly, there's an interesting aspect to this, because it turns out that things do depend on the wavelength of this thermal radiation. If you have an interference experiment where the molecule is in two places at the same time, so to speak, and these two places are apart by a distance d, then if you emit thermal radiation with a wavelength much larger than d, this would actually not be sufficient to resolve this distance. And if you go through the math, you actually do find that such photons are not bad. They are not going to lead to decoherence. Only the photons with a wavelength that is small enough to figure out that the particle is either up here or down there, only those photons are dangerous and they will lead to decoherence. So, interesting aspect. Next, if you look at one of these mechanical systems like these so-called cantilevers with an attached mirror that people study in cavity optomechanics, if they start to vibrate, if they start to vibrate back and forth, they will actually be able to emit sound waves. Even if there is no gas around, they are typically attached to something, for example, a chip, and then they will radiate sound waves into the chip. And in this case, all the atoms of the chip can be considered the bath. And by absorbing energy from the system, they also give rise to decoherence, so sound waves. And then finally, talking of electromagnetism, if you have a quantum system that is sensitive to electric or magnetic fields, then any fluctuations in those electric or magnetic fields can also easily lead to decoherence. And what I've tried to draw here would be a qubit, made up of, in this case, a superconducting qubit made of two metallic islands. This is all on the scale of a micrometer. It sits on a chip. And the different qubit states are distinguished by the charge distribution in those states. So it's very dangerous if there is a fluctuating electric field nearby. How could this arise? Well, in any real material, there may be some defects. And in these defects, there may be, for example, an electron located at either one or another position, and it will over time fluctuate between these two positions. And if this electron that fluctuates is close to the qubit, then the qubit will feel a fluctuating electric field, and that gives rise to decoherence. So that's one possibility. Another possibility is if you have a magnetic field that is fluctuating because there are some spins in the bath. Okay, so many different ways for things to go wrong. And this is the main reason why at the moment you can't buy a big quantum computer with many qubits, because all of these sources of decoherence are there. People are working very hard to fight against them. And as we just saw previously, if you scale up the number of individual subsystems, like the number of qubits, then you run exactly into this problem that we discussed for the cat, namely that the decoherence scales unfavorably with a number of units. So this is the reason you can't buy a quantum computer yet. Okay. So any questions still about decoherence in general, the system bath picture or the macroscopic superpositions? I know there's much, much more, and there's beautiful mathematics to describe it. Treating the details of the fluctuating environment. That's a lot of statistics actually going into this, but unfortunately we don't have the time. Okay, so I don't see any question right now. So let's move on to something completely, entirely different. So we looked at measurement and decoherence and they were related. Now it's a completely new chapter. And what I want to discuss now is different interpretations of quantum mechanics. So what I mean by that is stories that we are telling about what does the wave function mean? What does quantum mechanics mean? There is, in these interpretations, no disagreement about the predictions. So you would always use the same formulas, the Schrödinger equation or the Heisenberg equations of motion to make predictions. All of these interpretations entirely agree in the predictions. So in that sense, operationally, they are indistinguishable. However, it's still worthwhile to try to figure out different possible stories behind the predictions. And one reason is that maybe one story is easier to comprehend than another story. So it's good for us to understand quantum mechanics, even if the predictions are exactly the same. Also, different stories, different interpretations could give rise to different suggestions for modifications or extensions. And these extensions, then, they could be different in their predictions. So it's good for understanding maybe different perspectives. Even having different perspectives is good for understanding it better, even if you don't commit to any of these perspectives. And you also get new ideas for possible extensions or modifications, which ideas, and these ideas might turn out to be different depending on the interpretation you start with. So the first interpretation of quantum mechanics around was, of course, what is typically known as the Copenhagen interpretation. We talked about it already. It has two pieces, famously. First, there's the quantum evolution described by the Schrödinger equation or the Heisenberg equations of motion. Doesn't matter which formalism you use. It's smooth, it's continuous, it's very reliably tested in many experiments, so no problem there. And then, quite apart from that, as an extra ingredient, there's the measurement. Measurement being implemented by using a classical macroscopic apparatus. There's the sudden discontinuous collapse of the wave function. There's the Born rule to calculate the probability for different outcomes. And what is maybe most important is this emphasis that it's only via the measurement that observables become real. And only those observables which you measure in a particular setup, they become real. Any other observables that you could have measured but didn't, they don't become real. In particular, that includes all the non-commuting observables. So if you measure position, that has become real, but don't talk about momentum. If you measure momentum, don't talk about position. And so as a consequence of that, of course, there are also no trajectories. Not only are there no trajectories easily measurable, that's clear anyway from these considerations like the Heisenberg microscope and the unavoidable perturbation you bring about by the measurement, but you should not even think of them conceptually, because people like Bohr very early on realized that you run into trouble, that you will run into trouble if you start to think about the values that certain observables would have even in the absence of measurement. You run into trouble. And one example of this, of course, are Bell's inequalities. So if you try to make up any local hidden variable theory, which would be talking about the values of observables even in the absence of measurement, you run into deep trouble and eventually you run into contradiction even with experiment. So no trajectories. That's, so to speak, a firm rule of Copenhagen. So the first interpretation I want to discuss is an interpretation that violates this rule that there should be no trajectories. And that is rather famous, and maybe some of you have heard of it already. That would be the so-called Bohm pilot wave theory or Bohm's hidden variable theory. So the question is, can we use trajectories to describe the outcome of quantum mechanical experiments? Can we use something like this, a particle following a specific trajectory and then maybe impinging on a screen? Are we allowed to do this and get the right answers? And it's a little bit strange even to ask this question in the light of what I just said before, that Copenhagen makes such a big point of saying, look, no, you cannot ever measure simultaneously position and momentum. Specifying a whole trajectory, of course, also means automatically that you are specifying the velocity in particular at every point in time, because you can derive it from the trajectory, and therefore you specify the momentum, but you are not allowed to talk about the position and the momentum at the same time. So it seems that this is ruled out from the start. Nevertheless, David Bohm introduced something that does work based on trajectories. And this was a theory he came up with in 1952. He had been an assistant of Albert Einstein. It turns out that when you dig a little bit deeper into the history of quantum physics, you find that even de Broglie, the originator of the matter wave concept, had actually thought of this earlier, back then in 1927. And if you dig even deeper, you will find that even Albert Einstein himself had, even before 1917, already had this idea. At the time, of course, he didn't have access to the full quantitative theory of quantum mechanics. There was no Schrödinger equation, but the concepts behind this theory he had already in his mind and actually discussed rather widely. Okay, so how does this work? How does this seemingly impossible pilot wave theory make things work and use trajectories to give correct predictions of quantum mechanical experiments? And I will now describe the ingredients. The first thing is, at time t, the particle will be described both by a wave function and its current location in space. Maybe I should call it psi of x and t, and the position of the particle in space. So the trajectory, if you like, the thing that we should avoid. The trajectory is taken serious. Now, how can I obtain these trajectories? How do I find out about these trajectories? It turns out the idea is that you should think of a stochastic setting where particles can start out at different points in space, and then they will evolve differently along different trajectories. And it turns out that in this theory, you have to assume that these different points in space, they are at the initial point in time distributed according to a probability density. And this is not just an arbitrary probability density, but it's actually the probability density given by psi squared. So r of zero, the position at time zero, is stochastically distributed, and it's distributed according to psi square. More specifically, psi of r of zero, comma zero, because the time is zero squared. And so if you like this blue area, you could think as psi as psi squared at time zero. So that's the first ingredient, so to speak. At some time, you have to fix the proper probability distribution. what do you do after that? How do the trajectories evolve? And if we think of trajectories, usually we would think of equations of motion. So the question is, how do we get the equation of motion for the trajectory? Well, the first thing is you have to assume that psi evolves according to the Schrödinger equation. And we know that Schrödinger equation, so it's a smooth evolution, no problem. But how does R evolve? And that is the famous equation of motion that David Bohm came up with. So there's an equation for the velocity of the particle, not the acceleration, interestingly. In Newtonian dynamics, you would talk about the acceleration. Here you have an equation for the velocity. And it turns out this velocity is related to the phase of the wave function. So let me just say, or let me just define psi at x and time t is somehow the magnitude of psi, which I can split off, times a phase factor. And this phase factor contains the phase. And now if you have this phase available, after all you solved Schrödinger's equation, so you know the wave function. If you have this phase available, you should take this phase field and take its gradient. That's the idea. The velocity will be proportional to the gradient of the phase field. And we will check in a moment that this gives rise to very reasonable looking results. You should evaluate this gradient of the phase field at the current position of the particle. And the gradient of the phase field would have dimension 1/distance. In order to turn it into a velocity, actually, you have to multiply by h/m. And so this is, so to speak, the Bohmian velocity field. I could say this is V, some velocity field defined in this way, evaluated at the current position of the particle. Okay, so that's what he writes down. And the claim, as we will see in a moment, is if you start from this, if you start with the right distribution at some particular time zero, and then you evolve according to this equation of motion, it turns out that the statistical distribution of positions, even at all later times, will completely match what you would expect from the Schrödinger equation. But first, I want to ask, okay, is there a question just about the formalism here? Is the formula clear? It seems so. Okay. So next thing is, why does this make sense? Well, think of something like a plane wave. Or if you like, a wave packet that is mostly a plane wave, but maybe multiplied by a smooth envelope. And so I would have something like this. Okay, so this is my wave packet. And I can draw for you the lines of constant phase. So the lines of constant phase are the lines of constant k times r. If k is pointing along this direction, then the lines of constant phase must be perpendicular to this vector. So actually, they will look like this. Now, the gradient of the phase, of course, in this case, or always, is perpendicular to the lines of constant phase. And in this case, the gradient is basically just k. So if we disregard this very smooth envelope, then the gradient of the phase is actually k in this example. And then if you multiply this with h/m, you get the Bohmian velocity. But you see, this is actually the velocity that you would expect because its momentum divided by mass. So at least for a particle propagating freely in space, according to some wave packet that has one more or less definite momentum, you get exactly the right velocity. So all of these trajectories, all of these particles in this particle cloud that you can imagine, they are moving at the correct velocity. Okay. Now, the question is, does this give us what we want? Because if you remember, what we want is really that with this prescription, we will be able to make the right predictions, in particular, the right predictions about the distribution in space, the stochastic distribution in space of the particle. So we now try to prove that Bohm's theory gives us the expected result. And there's a question here. If two identical states are prepared, they would take the very same path through a diffraction experiment. Does that mean the pilot wave theory does not allow identical states? Oh, no, no. Very good question, though. We have to distinguish very precisely here between the quantum state, that is the wave function on the one hand, and then the position of the particle, which is actually a hidden variable. Maybe I should say this. This is the hidden variable of Bohm's pilot wave theory. And so when you say identical states, I presume you mean identical wave function states, but they can still have randomly different r of t, randomly different position. Oh, identical r of t. Well, in that case, they will follow exactly the same trajectory, but that is okay. Maybe we can discuss this question again once I have proven what follows from Bohm's theory, and then you will see what is actually the claim. So first, I just want to introduce a definition. Let me introduce the probability density in Bohm's ensemble. So the question is, what do I mean by Bohm's ensemble? Well, here I just mean the ensemble of different the ensemble of different possible positions of the particle. We are talking about a quantum interference experiment here with a single particle, but I imagine that if I run it again and again and always prepare it in the same wave function, nevertheless, according to this prescription, each time I will have a different stochastically chosen position. And if I imagine all these different positions as starting points and the corresponding trajectories, then it's like as if I have a point cloud that evolves in time. And so this is the ensemble we are talking about. But nevertheless, it's only a single particle. Okay. And so the claim, the mathematical claim, is now the following. If the probability density of Bohm's ensemble is equal to the probability density given by the wave function at time zero, that is something we have to put in, that is an assumption. Then, however, it follows quite in general that they match also at all later times. And that's the interesting non-trivial part. So O of t is also equal to psi of t for all later times. And that's nice, because it in particular will mean, as we will see in a moment, if you then describe an interference experiment, the probability density of where the particles hit the screen is exactly what you would have hoped it to be. Okay. So that's a little mathematical challenge, but not too challenging. What we can always say if we have such a situation of a probability density evolving smoothly in space, we have, of course, conservation of probability. So we have something like a continuity equation. In other words, the time derivative of this probability density will be given by minus the divergence of an associated probability current density. To make it really clear, I put an index boom here. And what is this probability current density? Well, I have an ensemble of particles and a velocity field V. So even from hydrodynamics, people know how this thing works. You multiply the density with the velocity field, and that gives you the current density. And then indeed, the first equation holds dt, d rho over dt is minus the divergence of this current density. So, of course, what we would like to prove is that the time evolution of the Bohmian probability density rho is actually equal to the time evolution of the Schrödinger probability density psi squared. This is the thing we want to prove, so I cannot take it as an assumption. If that is true, then of course we are done. Because if that is true, then if they match at the first point in time and their derivatives match, then they will also match at the second point in time. And again, their derivatives will match, and so on and so on. So we go forward step by step. So if I can prove this, then I'm done. Now, the time derivative of the Schrödinger probability density psi squared, we have also seen before, can also, of course, be written in this continuity equation ansatz. So it's minus the divergence of another current density that is, so to speak, the quantum mechanical probability current density. So if I can show that the left-hand side is equal to this right-hand side, then I'm absolutely done. And now the question is, now we have to insert what is our Bohm probability, what is our Bohm velocity field? Well, we just said this, it's the gradient of the phase times h bar divided by m. Now, what is rho? This is the Bohmian probability density, but according to the assumption up to the present time, it is actually equal to the Schrödinger probability density. So I can insert it here, and then I have h bar divided by m times gradient phi. And now there's an interesting identity. So what I just wrote here is actually equal to the following. It's equal to the real part of psi star minus I h bar gradient divided by m times psi. And the thing in the middle could be identified as the velocity operator because it's actually the momentum operator divided by m. Now this, you can go through a few steps of calculation to show that these are actually equal. Once you have convinced yourself, then we are done, because it turns out that if you go back to a discussion, and I think we had in the first lecture of this course, this is actually equal to the quantum mechanical probability current density. So we have shown what we wanted to show. The Bohmian probability current density is equal to the quantum mechanical probability current density under the assumption that the current Bohmian probability density is equal to the current Schrödinger probability density. If this is so, then also the time derivatives will be equal. If that is so, the rho and the psi squared will also match after this time step, and then I can repeat the argument. Okay, so that's great. So that is the magic. That means that if I now conduct measurements at any point later in time of the position of the particle, then I will get exactly the right statistics, namely the statistics expected according to Born, expected according to psi squared. So if we can somehow reduce all measurements to position measurements eventually, then we are done. Because then we exactly reproduce the correct statistics. No, sorry. So we are reproducing the quantum mechanical predictions. And so, of course, if you want to get a flavor of how this is going on, the best thing to look at is the double slit. And it's really, really nice to see how Bohm's theory works for the double slit. So again, I have my double slit, the famous double slit. What I would do now is somehow I would first try to figure out what does my wave function do. So I have plane waves coming in from the left. Then of course I have them spreading after the slit, and then I will have a more complicated interference pattern evolving. It's actually difficult to draw all of this, and there will be further interference fringes. Anyway, you get a complicated interference pattern. And the question is now, if I know this wave function, I've calculated the wave function, and in particular, I know the phase field, how do the Bohmian trajectories look like? And so that's very interesting. Of course, they do depend exactly on where I start, but for example, let me start over here. Then I may get something like this. And if the screen is somewhere there, then my particle will hit the screen there. If I start at a slightly different position here, then maybe I undergo another trajectory and end up in the vicinity. And so there will also be trajectories that lead to here, and there will be even more trajectories that lead to the middle. And likewise for particles coming from the other slit. So something like this, going to the middle, and then there's the second interference maximum. Also some particles will end up here. And then there's the third maximum. There will be some particles ending up here. So this is what Bohm tells us. Interestingly, these trajectories will never cross, because at each point in space, of course, the gradient of phi has a definite value. So there's a definite velocity field, and therefore a definite direction of the trajectory, so they can never cross. And you get exactly the right probability distribution on the screen. So to speak, this is the probability distribution. Well, psi squared at this time, but it is equal actually to what the Bohmian ensemble would give me. And then just to say it again, in any given run of the experiment, when you only inject a single particle, Bohm would tell you, aha, you need to evolve the wave function, but then this particle had a definite starting point, and it follows a definite trajectory, and it happens to end up, say, here. But in order to see this interference fringes, of course, you have to repeat the experiment many, many times. So you end up stochastically with many different positions of the initial, many different initial particle positions. And because of that stochasticity, you also end up with a seemingly stochastic pattern of particles impinging on different pieces of the screen. So that's it. And it's amazing. You are guaranteed to get exactly the right distribution. And you have obviously introduced trajectories. You have not gotten rid of the Schrödinger equation or the wave function. That would have been even more fantastic. But in any case, now you're talking about trajectories. Now, this is already pretty nice. But And I hope everyone is so far with me, but there are some disadvantages, let's say, or surprises lurking in Bohm's theory. And the first surprise is that if instead of applying it to a double slit experiment, you would apply it to one of the simplest quantum mechanical systems that was solved very early, namely the hydrogen atom, or in fact, any ground state of a quantum mechanical system. So that's the second example. So here you have your nucleus, and then you calculate the wave function, and of course, you know, you get something isotropic around the nucleus. It falls off at large distances, so that also gives me the probability density. But now if you ask Bohm, okay, predict what does the electron do there? Maybe you would have in mind, okay, it goes around the nucleus in some way, but no, the electron just sits there without any motion. And that's a little bit disappointing, maybe, at least if you had a certain picture in mind. Why does it just sit there? Well, because if you calculate the gradient of the phase, that's actually zero. The phase still evolves in time, e to the minus I omega t, as it does for any stationary state, but there is no pattern in, there is no gradient phi in real space. And that is actually true in any stationary state, even for the higher excited states, unless you produce a superposition. But for any stationary state, this will be true. Unless we have a magnetic field, then things do change. Then you can have currents inside stationary states. But otherwise, in any stationary state, the particle will just sit there and do nothing. So maybe that's not what you hoped for. It's still consistent with the predictions of quantum mechanics, because if you start with the right probability distribution of the electron at time zero, then it will just keep sitting there. But that also means the probability distribution at any later time will be correct, trivially. Okay. Let's go back maybe to the more interesting situations where we have some gradient of the phase, maybe where we even have time dependence of the wave function. And let's ask, what is the time evolution of the velocity field? So maybe we are looking now at something like a hydrodynamic version of quantum mechanics. Okay, so remember V is H bar over M times grad phi. So what is the time derivative of V? Oh yeah, so there's already more advanced questions. I don't understand how this can be extended to quantum field theory. There you have functional Schrödinger equation. Seems very strange to me, a physical wave functional. Okay, so how to answer? I have so far only concentrated on a single particle, but since you are already bringing up the question, of course, if you had multiple particles, then say the wave function as we know would depend on multiple coordinates. To each of these particles would be assigned its own trajectory. So for example, there would be the trajectory of particle number one. And this would then be h bar divided by m1 times the gradient with respect to r1 of the phase of this wave function. And interestingly, this phase, of course, also depends on all the other coordinates at the same time, at least in general. We will discuss this a little bit later. But that's the ansatz you take for the case where you have many particles, and then you know that you can understand a quantum field as kind of a continuum limit of many particles. So if I have many particles in a chain coupled by springs, and then I make these springs ever smaller and I have more and more particles, then eventually I will go to the limit of a quantum field. I don't know whether you like the result, but at least this is how Bohm's theory would deal with this. Haha, can these trajectories exceed the speed of light if the phase of the wave function is prepared accordingly? Well, yes, actually, yes, they can do this. But maybe we shouldn't complain too much, because at the moment here, this is a non-relativistic theory, and even the underlying Schrödinger equation we are using is, of course, also non-relativistic. There are relativistic extensions of Bohm. But these trajectories can, in principle, exceed the speed of light, actually. Okay. I hope still you bear with me. Let's take a step back and defer these more advanced questions to a little bit later. Let's have a look again at the velocity field, because this is the central quantity, and let's see how it evolves in time. Now, I don't want to go through the calculation, but basically what you can do is you say, the velocity field depends on the phase. How does the phase evolve in time? Well, that depends on how the wave function evolves. How do I know this? Well, from the time-dependent Schrödinger equation. So you basically have to bring in the time-dependent Schrödinger equation, in this case, written down for a single particle. Then you can go through many steps. I don't want to go through the details here, but what you find in the end is something very appealing, actually. So you find the time derivative of the velocity field is minus v grad v plus a certain force, which I will discuss in a moment, which I call the Bohmian force. So maybe let me first discuss the first term. If this is well known to people who have studied hydrodynamics, so if these are the flow lines of a hydrodynamic field, the streamlines, and I consider now a trajectory, so there will be r of t and the particle streaming along this, actually this is already the velocity, then it turns out that because this particle that is moving is constantly moving to places with a different value of the velocity field, where the velocity points in a different direction, if you have the equation of motion of the particle and it is experiencing a certain force, then in the equation of motion of the velocity field, you always get this term. And in hydrodynamics, it's called an advective term. So this only comes about because you switch from the frame of reference of the particle that is co-moving with the particle to a fixed lab frame of reference. And there you describe the velocity field. So it's nothing magic. People know this in hydrodynamics. But the question is, what is this force? What's this magic force acting on our particle? And this is interesting. So this force can be written as minus the gradient of a potential, as any good conservative force should be written. And what is this potential? Well, first and foremost, it has a contribution from the real physical potential, for example, harmonic oscillator potential or Coulomb potential, what have you. But there is another term, and this other term depends on the wave function. It actually depends on the Laplacian applied to the magnitude of the wave function divided by the magnitude of the wave function. So this is a little bit funny. This has a name. It's called the quantum potential. The Bohmian quantum potential. And so so what we have learned is, of course, the particles do not just feel the external potential. This would be too simple. Then you could basically predict the outcome of quantum mechanics by following the classical trajectories of particles whose, it's as if they, you had overdamped particles whose velocity is governed by a force, and that this force is proportional to minus the gradient of the external potential, and no correction to that. That would be too simple. Then there would be no quantum mechanics in there. So what is this quantum potential? And so let me skip this. This quantum potential is best explained in an example. Suppose I have a harmonic oscillator. But of course, the hydrogen atom works also. It's just easier this way. And let me draw the wave function in the ground state. That's the wave function. And now, what is this quantum potential? Well, if you just insert the wave function, which is a Gaussian for the ground state, and you calculate this quantum potential, it's basically the curvature of the magnitude of this wave function. And what you find is an inverted parabola. So why is that relevant? Well, because if you add to that quantum potential the actual external potential, the harmonic oscillator potential, then you find they just balance each other. It's a constant. And so if they balance each other and the force that we were talking about is the sum of the gradients of both of them, then this force will just be zero. Yeah. So the overall potential, so to speak, is flat. This is the overall potential, it's flat. And we get a force that is zero. And that is then, in this language, the reason why the particle, the Bohmian particle, it just sits still. There is, so to speak, the force exerted by the external potential, which would try to push the particle towards the origin. But then there's the force exerted by the quantum potential, which exactly balances this force. And so overall, the particle sits still. People have invented another way of interpreting this thing. They say this is a kind of quantum pressure. Why does it make sense to give that name to this extra part of the force? Well, if you look in particular at the harmonic oscillator, the force is pushing outwards away from the region where psi is large. And so this is similar to pressure in a gas of particles, where the pressure would push you away from the regions of high density. Okay. I also want to briefly mention that all of this slightly hydrodynamic picture, without the interpretation of trajectories, this was actually known before. It's called Madelung's hydrodynamic formulation of quantum mechanics, where you write down not an equation of motion for the wave function, but actually two coupled equations, one for a velocity field, which is somehow driven by this extra force, the Bohmian force that we just discussed, plus another equation for the density, which is just the equation of continuity. So these two equations together are called Madelung's formulation of quantum mechanics. You can use them as an alternative way of solving the Schrödinger equation if you like, if that helps you in any way. So the psi, which is complex, is somehow replaced here by rho and v, which are real valued. Okay. What else? We should come back to the momentum or the velocity. So one obvious question is, well, it's all good and great that you can reproduce quantum mechanical predictions for the distribution of particle positions, but what about velocity? What about momentum? And so the first thing we should note right away is that this velocity field that the particles follow in Bohm's theory is not connected to the momentum distribution that is predicted by quantum mechanics. And the easiest way to see this is in stationary states, we have, we have V equals zero because the gradient of phi equals zero. So particles don't move. But then on the other hand, if you ask quantum mechanics, well, what about the momentum in those states? In particular, if I calculate the variance of the momentum, how large are the momentum fluctuations? Then they would be non-zero, actually. Quantum mechanical momentum fluctuations in the ground state of the hydrogen atom are really large. So so that is, there is no connection there. But at least we can say the following. If I average the velocity in this Bohmian ensemble, then I will get the same thing as if I calculate the average velocity operator according to quantum mechanics. So at least that holds. Again, however, it's a little bit disappointing that the statistical predictions only work for position distribution and not for momentum distribution. And now the justification that Bohm would serve is the following. He says, well, look, if you really do an experiment and you want to measure the momentum, how are you doing this? And the answer would be, well, at the end of the day, this is by measuring the position in a suitably constructed experiment. How would this experiment look like? So you would measure the momentum really via the velocity. And how do you measure the velocity? Well, you measure that by a time of flight experiment. So what is a time of flight experiment? For example, just to give an example, let's say we have again have the harmonic oscillator. Now you want to measure the momentum distribution of particles inside this harmonic oscillator ground state. What can you do? I mean, also in real experiments nowadays, one way is to switch off the trap and have the particle and have the wave function expand, actually, which is what will happen. And then after some time, you actually measure the position distribution in space. This is done, for example, in cold atom experiments. And you then say, aha, I know the velocity because I know where all of this started near the origin of my coordinate system. And if I measure the distance that the particles have covered in a certain time, I know their velocity, and therefore I know their momentum. And so by doing this for a cloud of particles or many repeated iterations of the same experiment, you can also get access to the momentum distribution. And now we want to see, okay, so you measure the position distribution. And you infer, therefore, the velocity distribution and therefore the momentum distribution. Oopsie. There are more questions here. So in the Madelung formulation, which I just discussed, you should manage to write Bohmian force as a function of rho and V, right? Yes, that is perfectly right. And this is also correct because here it's the Laplacian of the magnitude of psi, which is the square root of the density rho. So yes, I can write this quantum pressure only in terms of the density. The second question was, What about more exotic representations as Fogg Bergmann? Here I have to confess my ignorance. I don't even know about this representation. So maybe we can have a discussion on the Google discussion group. Okay, but let me just finish this here and then we are finished for today. How would Bohm's theory describe this experiment? And this is fairly interesting to see. If this is the position and that is the time, then initially, of course, in the stationary ground state of my harmonic oscillator, if I think of my Bohmian ensemble, they're just sitting there. They are sitting there and doing nothing, so they are still. But then as my wave function expands, and I can somehow indicate the expansion of my wave function after I switched off my potential, after my wave function expands, then actually some gradient of phi will develop. So this kind of wave function has a non-vanishing gradient of the phase field. And so what this means is actually the particles are doing this. And so this is somehow exactly, this is very nice. This is exactly what you would expect classically. So the slower particles are more in the middle and the faster particles are more on the outside. And it will give you the correct distribution that you expect also quantum mechanically, because in the end, you have converted everything to a position distribution. And we already know that Bohm gives the right position distribution. Okay, here is a follow-up to the question about the Fogg-Bergmann representation, where you represent creation annihilation operators as complex Z and D over DZ. Okay. But this, I guess, is a little bit confined to the, is this confined to the harmonic oscillator now? Or should I think in terms of a quantum field theory, where even if in the end I describe a single particle, it's just an excitation in the field? Do I describe a single particle in a harmonic oscillator, or do I describe a single particle as one excitation in a quantum field? Oh, mainly quantum field theory. Honestly, I don't know whether people have tried to somehow to match this Bohm's pilot wave theory with these kinds of representations. Okay, but maybe there are other simpler questions for the moment about Bohm's theory so far as we have discussed it. Next time we will actually discuss many particles in Bohm's theory, and then we will learn that although it is a hidden variable theory, it is a non-local hidden variable theory. And of course, this is as it should be, because we have already proven that local hidden variable theories can never be consistent with the predictions of quantum mechanics. Okay, so then there's another question. Is it true for all quantum theories that any measurement can be treated as a position measurement? Well, it's a little bit dangerous question. The point is that, of course, if I have a spin or an energy eigenstate of an atom, then okay, so what? What about this? But if you want to apply a framework like Bohm, you would still say, well, maybe I'm measuring my spin by shooting a particle in the vicinity of my spin, and it will be deflected according to the magnetic field exerted by the spin, left or right. And in the end, I will still measure particles impinging on a screen. Then there is photons that makes things a little bit more difficult, because it's hard to treat them as individual particles. You would have to go to a quantum field and things become more abstract. But in principle, this can also be done. So you always try to reduce everything to position measurements. But I have to say that eventually it becomes a little bit tricky.
Okay. Good. Okay. Maybe then that's enough for today. I will still let you know on the Google discussion group when we finally have this tutorial. So the tutor was just ill a little. So I will tell you when we have the tutorial, and then I will meet you next time. And next time we will continue to discuss Bohm's theory for many particles and its non-locality. And then we will also start discussing a very exciting different version of trajectory-based hidden variable theory, which is called Nelson's stochastic quantization, which is probably something that very few or none of you have heard about ever. Okay, so with that, see you next time, I would say.